Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Writing About Animals in the Age of Revolution by Jane Spencer, narrated by Cat Gould. 1. Introduction. Human and Animal Rights in the 18th Century. In 1798, the young Tory politician and future Prime Minister, George Canning, along with the diplomat George Ellis, wrote New Morality, imitating the style of Alexander Pope, but tackling what they saw as the much worse vices of their own time in comparison to those of the great satirist's milder age. The new philosophy of modern times, espoused by French revolutionaries and their English supporters, was the target. Published in the final issue of the counter-revolutionary periodical The Anti-Jacobin, or Weekly Examiner, the poem employs time-honoured modes of attack, representing its targets as monsters and beasts: Thomas Paine, Helen Maria Williams, William Godwin, and Thomas Holcroft are creeping creatures, venomous and low. As well as animalizing radical writers, the poem satirizes modern attitudes that overvalue animals themselves. The then fashionable, and fashionably derided, quality of sensibility is personified as a woman who has read too much Rousseau and now feels for the crushed beetle first, the widowed dove, and all the warbled sorrows of the grove. Next, for poor suffering guilt, and last of all, for parents, friends, a king, and country's fall. Excessive care for small animals, long seen as a typical vice of silly, spoiled ladies, takes on a sinister cast here as a sign of the perverse, French-inspired values that threaten Britain from within. Shortly after this poem was published, James Gilray illustrated it in caricature in the first issue of the Anti-Jacobin Review and Magazine. Gilray's New Morality shows sensibility as one of three statues of female figures. The others are justice and philanthropy, representing corrupted versions of morality to which various radical politicians are paying homage. Sensibility weeps over a dead bird in her hand while she treads on the decapitated head of Louis XVI. Taking part in a well-established anti-sentimental tradition of mocking the claims of feeling as both false and feminine, poem and caricature alike mount a gendered attack on compassion for animals as a woman's vice, involving the inversion of proper values. Sensibility's misplaced sorrow for the bird is just one example of the way that animal representation in the late 18th century was intimately bound up with the defence of, and, as we will hear, with the challenge to, human hierarchies. Questions of human-animal relations were intertwined with those of the relations between human beings in terms of gender, race, class, and age, making animals central figures in the debate about revolution. Animal imagery and the monstrous mingling of human and animal pervade Gilray's cartoon. Prominent is the huge sea monster, Leviathan, given the head of the Whig Duke of Bedford and ridden by a number of politicians, including the radical Whig leader Charles James Fox. A host of English Jacobin writers appear in the caricature. In one detail, the poets Samuel Taylor Coleridge and Robert Southey, both known in 1798 for their radical politics, are shown with asses' heads. Their images combine a reference to their own sympathetic poetry about animals with an allusion to Canning's satire on female readers, the fair votaries of sensibility who weep o'er a dead jackass. The dead ass encountered by Yorick in Sterne's A Sentimental Journey. Sympathy for animals, combining stupid, feminized sentimentality and ridiculous revolutionary views, is emblematized here by writers who have turned into asses. As the later chapters of this study will show, the multivalent ass is a significant figure within all kinds of writing about animals in the age of revolution, but it is joined by many others. Animals of many different species pervaded late 18th century disputes about the rights of man. British writers turned their attention to animal life as they engaged with a culture profoundly affected by revolutions in France and America and struggle for reform at home. The conservative high church clergyman, William Jones, thought that the very notion of natural rights reduced people to animality. Natural rights, he said, were not the rights of a Christian, nor of a civilized, nor of a social being, but of an animal only. He wondered why they who assert rights to man in this capacity, i.e., merely in his animal being, do not allow the claim of right in other animals, and why they do not carry their principle, where it must go in spite of them, from the rights of man to the rights of beasts. In fact, some of them did. The agricultural writer and revolutionary sympathiser John Lawrence included a chapter on those very rights in his treatise on horses, proposing that the rights of beasts be formally acknowledged by the state and that a law be framed upon that principle to guard and protect them from acts of flagrant and wanton cruelty. In his view, it was no mistake to attach rights to mere animal life, for life, intelligence, and feeling necessarily imply rights. Animals were central to political debate not only because they served, in the way they had for centuries, as crucial figures in which to couch human argument, but also because of a change by this period in the conception of their relation to human society. A movement towards a greater recognition of human-animal kinship and of the moral claims of animals. As Keith Thomas showed in his landmark study of early modern English attitudes to the natural world, entrenched notions of human uniqueness and ascendancy over the beasts were progressively challenged, so that by the late 18th century, animals had moved from being mere brutes or beasts to being fellow beasts, fellow mortals, or fellow creatures, and finally to being companions, friends, and brothers. The significance of this shift remains a subject of dispute, with some critics contending that all attempts to plead on behalf of non-human animals really served exclusively human ends, such as self-flattery and social order. Such arguments seem to me to rely on too sharp a dichotomy between historic, human-centred purposes and an implicit ideal, often considered impossible, of pure commitment to the non-human. I will argue throughout this study that human social aims and genuine engagement with the claims of non-human animals were mixed together. There were important tensions between them, which the following chapters will explore, but the one did not cancel out the other. During the 18th century, a numerous group of writers expounded on human duties to their animal kin. Men, Alexander Pope claimed in 1713, are us accountable for the ill use of their dominion over creatures of the lower rank of beings, as they are for tyranny towards their fellow men. The clergyman Richard Dean drew attention in 1767 to the shared vulnerability of beast and human. However different they might be in the powers of understanding and reason, there is a pretty near resemblance betwixt them as to two cases. They feel alike and die alike. For William Cooper, writing The Task, in 1783-4, responsiveness to animals was a prerequisite for human social bonds. The heart is hard in nature and unfit for human fellowship, as being void of sympathy and therefore dead alike to love and friendship both, that is not pleased with sight of animals enjoying life. Children in the 1780s and after were advised in story after story to imagine themselves in the position of hurt animals. When a little boy in one of Dorothy Kilner's tales suspends a mouse by a string for the cat to play with, his father asks him how he would like that either myself or some great giant, as much larger than you as you are bigger than the mouse, should hurt and torment you. And I promise you, the smallest creature can feel as acutely as you. Am not I a fly like thee, or art not thou a man like me? Wrote Blake, addressing one of his songs of experience to a crushed insect. Such ideas were not new. Throughout the history of Western philosophy, heterodox thinkers have disturbed dominant anthropocentric views in order to vindicate the moral status of animals. Pope, in his Guardian article, appeals to one of the most influential of these, the first century Greek historian, Plutarch, who has more strokes of good nature in his writings than I remember in any author. Dean, arguing for the immortal souls of brutes, cites the support of some of the Christian fathers. As Nathaniel Wallach points out, writers throughout the early modern period concerned themselves with animal suffering, and an idea of the right animals had to moral consideration was already prevalent by the late 17th century. However, the distinctive feature of the 18th century's animal advocacy was its greatly increased cultural reach. The 18th century interest in sensation meant that significance was more widely attached to animals' ability to feel pain and pleasure, challenging the view, dominant since Aristotle, that it was the rational power which they were held to lack that was the primary consideration when deciding what treatment they merited. Most importantly, the extensive growth of print culture enabled the broad dissemination of a nexus of ideas about human-animal similarity and kinship, and the importance of the kindness that is etymologically linked to kinship. Writers in a huge variety of forms discussed the importance of treating animals well. The examples given earlier are from poetry, a periodical article, a theological essay, and a children's story, all influential opinion formers among a growing reading public. Many other forms of representation played an important part in this shift of view. Natural historians wrote in often sympathetic detail about animal life. Philosophers investigating the nature of man variously considered his relation to animals. Political thinkers compared tyranny to humanity and to beasts. Visual art took an important role, with Hogarth's famous Four Stages of Cruelty providing memorable illustrations of the proposition that cruelty to animals led to violence against people. Spread more widely across British society than ever before, concern about cruelty to animals led to a moral and, by the early 19th century, a parliamentary campaign to afford them some measure of protection. In its reappraisal of the relation between human and non-human animals, the late 18th century anticipated many of the debates continuing now within the multidisciplinary endeavour of human-animal studies. Matthew Colaco divides most recent approaches to human-animal relations into those based on identity and those based on difference. Identity approaches, stressing the ways in which non-human animals are similar to human beings, have formed the foundation for philosophies of animal rights and animal liberation, and for animal welfare movements. Difference approaches question humanism, and instead of seeking human-animal similarities, develop an appreciation of the manifold differences that exist between and among human beings and animals. 18th century animal advocacy is, broadly speaking, based on an identity approach, though this does not mean that it never takes difference into account. pro-animal writing of the 18th century can be seen as a forerunner of the utilitarian calculus of pains and pleasures that underlies Peter Singer's argument for consideration of non-human animal interests, of Tom Regan's emphasis on the moral significance of an animal's being the subject of a life, and of the concentration on animals' mental capacities within modern animal rights. 18th century animal advocates campaigned in the context of a reappraisal of distinctly human life as a new science of man, and new philosophies of human psychology emerged, what Giorgio Agamben has called the anthropological machine, the continuous set of attempts within Western thought to separate, within the human being, mere animal life from the properly human life that belongs to the political sphere, was at work. Its actions can be seen in shifts in the definition of what it is that makes humans so special. Since ancient times, reason had been understood as the mark of man's separation from the beasts. But this sharp division was blurred in the 18th century by claims for non-human animals' reasoning powers and by a new revaluation of the importance of the passions in human nature. As we will hear, human exceptionalism was repeatedly challenged and reasserted in different ways. In this book, I argue that the 18th century shift in attitudes to human-animal relations was intimately bound up with the emergence of radical political claims based on the concept of universal human rights. I focus on the literary representation that was central both to changing ideas about animals and to human politics. The establishment of animal rights as a literary subject laid the groundwork for animal welfare reforms, while a war of words was a crucial part of the struggle for human rights. A central concern here is what I call the new literature of animal subjectivity, writing which by various means attributed to non-human animals feeling, thought, suffering, consciousness, a point of view. Such writing persuaded readers to attach greater value to animal life, and as we will hear, it also had less obvious but still important effects on anthropocentric discourses concerning marginalized and disempowered human groups. The literature of animals and the literature of human radical politics in this period have both been extensively studied. Among others, David Perkins, Christine Kenyon-Jones, and Tobias Menley have shown how the spread of sympathetic representation of animals encouraged a wider recognition of non-human moral claims. Meanwhile, a rich scholarship concerned with the literary and cultural manifestations of political debate has revealed the emergent voices of disenfranchised groups of people. We have learned how people from the lower classes shaped radical culture in the 1790s and beyond. The work of black writers in the anti-slave trade campaign from the 1780s onwards have been brought to critical attention. Women's contribution to British writing about revolution has been recognised. The voices of children are not so easy to recover, except as they are mediated through those of adults. But the part played by writing for children in the politicised cultural debates of the period has been discussed. Less attention, however, has been given to the links between the period's anthropocentric political discourses and its writing about animals. Despite some significant discussions of animal figures and animal rights, animals themselves do not take centre stage in current histories of the struggle over human rights. There are good reasons to bring them, as this study does, to the centre. There was a tension at the heart of radical politics. The animality of human beings and the claims of non-human animals together troubled and complicated the notion of universal human rights on which reformist and revolutionary arguments were based. The idea of the rights of man, which underpinned both the American and the French revolutions, involved a particular understanding of human distinction. It was in his identity as a rational individual, who in the state of nature was free to govern himself, that his rights were understood to inhere. Notoriously, those who claimed the universal rights of man for themselves did not always apply them universally to others. The American revolutionists did not abolish slaveholding. British reform campaigners did not include women in their demands for manhood suffrage. They could countenance such limitations insofar as they understood differences within humanity. Differences of gender, race, social status, age, as marking different degrees of access to the distinctive qualities of the rights-bearing person. Rights belonged to the fully human, and what counted as fully human always depended, definitionally, on a sharp contrast with the animal. Members of oppressed human groups were likened to animals by their oppressors, and the struggle for rights and freedom always involved the claim to be fully human, the claim of distance and difference from animal life. The radical cultural revolution of the late 18th century brought animals into sharp focus through its claims for the human rights of groups who were seen, in very different ways, as close to animals: children, women, slaves, the working class. Abolitionists, feminists, and political reformers opposed the animalization of the people whom they championed, laying emphasis instead on their human uniqueness. In this respect, human rights arguments ran counter to those for animal rights, which stressed the close kinship between human and animal life. Yet, as we have already seen, some radical thinkers raised the idea of rights for non-human animals themselves, conceptualizing such rights as an extension of the rights of human groups. Indeed, the idea of rights for animals ran alongside the discussion of human rights from the start. Thus, animal rights discourse, from its inception, was caught up in a complex web of contradictory ideas. Recent human-animal philosophers have pointed out its difficulties in their critiques of rights-based claims. As Kelly Oliver expresses it, "If the man-animal binary is part and parcel of the history of rights discourse, then how can we use that same discourse to overcome it? How can we apply the rights of persons to animals if the very distinction between animals and persons is inherent in the notion of rights?" Their internal problems should not lead us to dismiss Enlightenment rights discourses, but rather to examine them all the more closely. In this study, I pay attention both to rights discourses and to more general writing about animals, showing that in various ways, writers attempted to address questions such as those Oliver raises. Some of them undermined the binary between human and animal. In doing so, they not only developed what Kalarko calls the identity approach to human-animal relations, but anticipated the approach he recommends as moving beyond both identity and difference, indistinction theory, which explores the animal-like qualities of humans rather than the human-like qualities of animals, with the aim of removing the human as the centre or chief point of reference. The two approaches have more in common than perhaps Kalarko allows, for to consider the human likeness to animals is, surely, to look at the animal likeness to humans from the other side. Some, not all, 18th century writers about animals took their views on human-animal similarity to the point of decentering the human. Meanwhile, as Heather Keenlyside has shown, the distinction between animals and persons was called into question within 18th century sentimental writing that personified the non-human. The literature of sentiment and sympathy, indeed, brought discourses of human and non-human rights together, Both human and animal rights owed their development in part to the emergence in the 18th century of a culture that placed a high value on compassion, and they mutually influenced each other. The new literature of animal subjectivity fed into shifting, softening attitudes towards animals, which in turn affected the representation of animals in more general political and social discourse. In complex and sometimes contradictory ways, the new value placed on non-human animal life played a leading part in the development of concepts of universal human rights. Animal and human rights were thus entangled together in a difficult relationship, which the following chapters will explore. My focus will often be on the tensions and contradictions between the two. I am not claiming that writers in the age of revolution solved these problems, but then neither have we, and we may yet learn something of value from the struggles of the earlier time. In this introductory chapter, I explain the basis for placing animals and animality at the centre of the age of revolution. Before dealing with rights discourses themselves, I outline the naturalistic and sympathetic perspectives which, by changing animal representation, enabled the development of animal rights. I discuss the changing attitudes to animals fostered within the growing discipline of natural history, which gave animal law a new scientific basis. Natural history influenced the ways animals were imagined in literature, encouraging a shift from previously dominant symbolic readings of animals towards a new understanding of the written animal, literally, as referring to real animals outside the text. Next, I discuss Hume's and Smith's philosophies of sympathy, showing that each had significant and distinct implications for literary animals. In the final part of the chapter, I trace the development and radicalization of ideas of natural rights, showing how the concept of human rights was locked in a complex and fraught relationship with that of rights for animals. As we trace changing attitudes, an important question to consider is the degree of closeness or distance between human lives and those of non-human animals. Historians, discussing kindness to animals as a feature of modern developments, such as intensified agriculture, urbanization, and consumer culture, often stress the modern creation of distance between human and animal lives. Harriet Ritvo argues that compassion for animals arose in the context of increasing human mastery over them, as evident in 19th-century selective breeding and the display of exotic animals in zoos. A note repeatedly sounded is of compensation for something lost or something worsening in human-animal relations. For Ritvo, what was lost was animals' power in human minds, as people systematically appropriated power they had previously attributed to animals, and animals became significant primarily as the objects of human manipulation. For Keith Thomas, the familiarity with animals common in rural early modern England was gradually eroded with urbanization till modern pet keeping became a solace within an atomistic society. Turner describes kindness to animals as an expression of the nostalgia felt by city dwellers seeking a sense of kinship with their rural past. Karen Raber, countering criticisms of pet relationships as mere substitutes for human intimacy, argues that they redress human alienation from the natural world. These compensations, in the end, have been inadequate. They did not stop the development of new and greater forms of animal exploitation. What emerged was a modern intensification of our strongly contradictory attitudes to animals, in which recognition of similarity with them coexists with a sense of alienation from them. These historical accounts sometimes exaggerate the connection between distance from animals and compassion for them. As Hilda Keen's 1998 History of Animal Rights shows, a sense of closeness to animals fostered anti-cruelty attitudes. The division of animals into country farm animals and city pets, she argues, oversimplifies. Many animals lived and worked in cities, and it was the proximity and visibility of their suffering that stimulated demands for change. Thomas Almaroth Williams's more recent study demonstrates in rich detail the extent to which working with animals from draft horses to guard dogs and rearing dairy cattle, pigs, and poultry remained central to people's lives in Georgian London. Keane's emphasis on the importance of the role of sight in prompting action against ill treatment has significant implications for my study, because sight and closeness were central to the practices of natural history and the process of sympathy. The close observation of animals by natural historians sometimes led, as Louise Daston has shown, to an emotional attachment, even to insects, as attention infused its objects with affect. Sympathy, said David Hume, operated when another's feelings came close to the observer. There is no human, and indeed no sensible creature, whose happiness or misery does not, in some measure, affect us, when brought near to us and represented in lively colours. Natural history and the philosophy of sympathy helped foster anti-cruelty attitudes by modelling ways that people could feel close to animals. The new literature of animals emerged, flowering especially in poetry and children's fiction. It helped to change attitudes to animals by representing them in new ways that both embodied and encouraged shifts happening in the scientific and philosophical realms. Poets and novelists adopted the naturalists' practice of detailed observation of animal behaviour and used it in their writing to revise and reanimate the fable tradition on which much previous animal representation had depended. Adam Smith's theory of sympathy fed into literary developments in imaginative engagement and perspective taking, encouraging readers to empathize with fictional characters. Such techniques, applied beyond the human world, enabled the literary creation of the animal as feeling subject. As I am concerned both with that emergence of the animal subject and with the relation between animal representation and human rights, I need to raise again a recurrent question within literary animal studies about the relationship between literal and symbolic readings of animals. How far are representations of non-human animals really about them, and how far are they using animals to write about other human subjects? Both kinds of representation were important in the 18th century, and indeed, they were usually mingled. Perhaps, in fact, they can never be completely disentangled. Nevertheless, as I will show, natural history and sympathy between them encouraged a shift towards more literal-minded ways of writing about animals. I will trace that shift in some of the animal writing of the century, suggesting that a new emphasis on a literal understanding of literary animals exerted pressure on the interpretation of animal symbols. The difference between literal and symbolic readings is encapsulated in two statements that have been so frequently quoted in recent scholarship about non-human animals as to attain proverbial status. Claude Lévi-Strauss's observation that animals are good to think, and Jeremy Bentham's insistence that, when considering animal rights, the question is not, can they reason, nor can they talk, but can they suffer? The one draws our attention to human thought, the other to non-human feeling. The one points to the crucial role non-human animals play in defining the human, the other to their significance in and for themselves. Lévi-Strauss's words could stand as a motto for a wealth of scholarship that has investigated the use of animals in human signification. Their versatile brilliance as metaphors for human qualities and human concerns, their starring roles in satires that attack human pride, their ability to represent the other against which humanity can be defined, and conversely, their tendency to remind humans that we are animals too. But such enquiries can be criticized for their anthropocentric assumptions, for discovering the eloquence of animals only to find that they speak exclusively of us, never of themselves. Whether non-human animals could reveal themselves within the texts created in human languages is a moot point. As Ludwig Wittgenstein put it in another much-quoted aphorism, even if a lion could talk, we could not understand him. Yet there remains a yearning to connect with other animals, to find ways of understanding them as acting beings, not passive objects, within our cultural life and history. John Simons recommends that we search our texts for the tracks they leave. Bentham's Can They Suffer? Serves to call us back to the animals in themselves. It calls attention, as Jacques Derrida remarked, to a non-power at the heart of power, a reframing of ability as vulnerability, which enables us to think of the mortality we share with animals. It also reminds us that suffering is an activity of the mind, asking not can they respond to painful stimuli, something the most Cartesian of early 20th century behaviorists would answer in the affirmative, but can they experience the pain? Bentham refers to other animals' much-disputed capacity for subjectivity. During the late 18th and early 19th centuries, the time Bentham was writing, animal representation was used both to think the human and, tentatively, but increasingly, to imagine the experience of the non-human. As far as the first of these is concerned, there was plenty for literary animals to do. A great deal of thinking and rethinking of the human was going on. The concept of what properly belonged to humanity was being reassessed under pressure from demands for recognition of the rights of man, and even woman. Non-human animals pervaded the discussions of human rights and liberties that raged through the last decades of the century and into the next, used figuratively as weapons in human quarrels. Especially common, as later chapters will show, was the use of animal names as insults. Defenders of slavery likened Africans to orang-outangs, great apes. Rebellious artisans called their rulers asses. Horace Walpole labelled the pro-revolutionary feminist Mary Wollstonecraft a hyena in petticoats. And the most famous animal insult of the time, Edmund Burke's jibe about learning being trodden down under the hoofs of a swinish multitude, prompted political reformers to co-opt the pig's identity for their own purposes. However, this was also a time when people were interested in what animals might be and mean, independently of human use. Natural theology, the endeavour to worship the author of creation by appreciating his works, had shown the way. In the late 17th century, a strand of natural theology challenged the anthropocentric bias of Christian culture. The pioneering ornithologist, John Ray, argued that beasts were not made for man alone. It is a generally received opinion that man is the end of the creation, as if there were no other end of any creature, but some way or other to be serviceable to man. Yet wise men nowadays think otherwise. Alexander Pope echoed this notion in the following century, admonishing his reader to recognize the independent emotional being of birds. Is it for thee the lark ascends and sings? Joy tunes his voice, joy elevates his wings. Is it for thee the linnet pours his throat? Loves of his own, and raptures swell the note. By By the 1790s, stories for children were taking part in the decentering of humanity. One story in John Aiken and Anna Letitia Barbeau's popular collection, Evenings at Home, was called What Animals Are Made For. Young Sophia, troubled by flies, wonders what purpose their existence can serve. Her father retorts, "Suppose a fly capable of thinking, would he not be equally puzzled to find out what men were good for?" He answers her question in terms of what we would now call ecological, and which express the 18th century idea of an economy of nature that pointedly includes humanity. Flies are of use because they eat up waste and putrefying matter, and in turn feed other creatures, while, when they suck our blood, there is no doubt that we are of use to them. Natural history. Natural history's centrality to Evenings at Home and other children's works is only one indication of the discipline's enormous cultural importance at this period. Drawing on earlier animal encyclopedias by Ray, Aldrovandi, and Gesner, but introducing new methods and reflecting an astonishing expansion in the number of plant and animal species known to them, European natural historians undertook ambitious projects of description and classification. What in the previous century had been a compendious study of animal lore, including mythical accounts along with natural observation, became a more scientific endeavour, laying the foundations for modern zoology and taxonomy. Vital questions were raised about the relationship between human and other animals. The Swedish naturalist Carl von Linné, or Linnaeus, developed in the 10th edition of his Systema Naturae, 1758, the binomial classificatory system, which is still the basis for modern taxonomies. Naming Homo sapiens and placing him within the genus he called primates, and which also included apes, monkeys, and bats, he upset notions of man's clear separation from the beasts. His French rival, Buffon, keeper of Paris's Jardin du Roi, with its large collection of animal specimens, produced his massive Histoire naturelle over four decades, 1749 to 88. His work encompassed plants, animals, the earth. For each species of animal, he aimed to describe not just its form, but its character and way of life. Though he included man among the animals as a fit subject for natural history, Buffon was keener than Linnaeus to emphasize humanity's unique dignity. Nevertheless, his ambivalent accounts of conquest over the wild creatures were capable of rousing troubling thoughts about human-animal relations. A British natural history tradition, flourishing from the late 17th century onwards, was further stimulated by the spread of ideas from Buffon and Linnaeus. Buffon's work was translated into English by William Kenrick in 1775 to 76 and William Smeeley in 1780 to 85. Oliver Goldsmith, drawing on Buffon for his History of the Earth and Animated Nature, 1774, popularized natural history for a wide readership. Smeeley's Philosophy of Natural History, 1790 to 97, drew philosophical reflections from the natural historian's discoveries. British naturalists' collections and descriptions of flora and fauna took part in the enterprise of nation-building. As Thomas Pennant explained, to emulate foreign naturalists was a patriotic endeavour. As Linnaeus has published an eulogium on Sweden, we shall here attempt a parallel and point out to the British reader his native riches. Do the heights of Torsberg or Swaku afford more instruction to the naturalist than the mountains of Cumberland or Carnarvonshire? Thomas Bewick collected specimens from all over the country to serve as models for the beautiful engravings published in The History of British Birds, 1797 to 1804. Pennant's friend, Gilbert White, took a more local focus attempting in his Natural History of Selborne a parochial history of natural productions and occurrences, which became one of the best loves of all naturalists' writings. Investigation into natural history had aesthetic implications. Natural historians appreciated the beauty their investigations revealed. As Lorraine Daston shows, they operated within a natural theology framework in which aesthetic and devotional considerations united in the concept of the natural world's utility. Science and poetry were not at this time considered antithetical or even necessarily separate endeavours. Erasmus Darwin disseminated his ideas on botany and the origins of life in heroic couplets in The Loves of the Plants and The Temple of Nature. Gilbert White's Selborne included his poem The Naturalist's Summer Evening Walk, complete with explanatory footnotes on the habits of mayflies and glowworms, woodlarks and cuckoos. As natural history and poetry mutually influenced each other, the detailed observations of the naturalists shifted expectations of the poetic treatment of animals. The neoclassical injunction to follow nature, with its view of nature as an eternal standard to which the poet's work should aspire, was replaced by advice to find inspiration in the discoveries of natural historians. Nature began to refer to external nature rather than predominantly to human nature. Introducing his British Zoology, Pennant dwelt on the importance of detailed natural knowledge for all artists, especially writers. Descriptive poetry is still more indebted to natural knowledge than either painting or sculpture. The poet has the whole creation for his range, nor can his art exist without borrowing metaphors, allusions, or descriptions from the face of nature, which is the only fund of great ideas. The depths of the seas, the internal caverns of the earth, and the planetary system are out of the painter's reach, but can supply the poet with the sublimest conceptions. Nor is the knowledge of animals and vegetables less requisite, while his creative pen adds life and motion to every object. Those who would judge the arts also needed natural history expertise. These views influenced John Aiken, who applied exacting standards of lifelike representation to natural images. In his essay On the Application of Natural History to Poetry, dedicated to Pennant, Aiken complained that poetic descriptions of natural objects suffered from a too cursory and general survey of objects without exploring their minuter distinctions and mutual relations. The remedy was accurate and attentive observation conducted upon somewhat of a scientific plan. Just as the artist, in this age of George Stubbs's wonderful animal paintings, needed to study anatomy, so the descriptive poet should view nature minutely to give his work the congruity and animation of real life. The drive towards greater naturalism meant that existing literary modes were reinterpreted, as animals in poetry and prose were increasingly modelled on the animals of natural historians. Fable is an important case in point, its 18th century manifestations illustrating, as well as the rise in naturalism, the mutual influence between fictional and scientific genres. Early natural historians rejoiced in replacing fable in the sense of false report, mythical monsters and fanciful accounts of animal behaviour, with scientific observation. In the 1690s, Edward Tyson introduced his report of the dissection of a chimpanzee with the declaration that as his chief design in this undertaking was the improvement of the natural history of animals, he would be rather concerned to find out the truth than to enlarge in the mythology, to inform the judgment than to please the fancy. Yet, as Louise Robbins demonstrates in her discussion of Buffon, Fable, in the sense of a story drawing a moral lesson from animal nature, remained an important feature of natural history. The ancient fables of Aesop and Pilpay provided traditional materials for such stories, repeatedly translated and adapted in the 17th and 18th centuries. They were, and some of them remain, widely recognized cultural reference points. With their tales of speaking animals, rounded off by morals for human society, often encoding references to current politics, they exemplified the practice of ostensibly writing about animals in order really to write about human life. Nevertheless, as Frank Palmieri has argued, many fables carry within themselves the seeds of a literal comment on animals and on human-animal relations. Take the fable of the dog and the wolf, in which the dog's boasts of his easy life as man's companion almost persuade the wolf to join him, till he notices the marks on the dog's neck left by collar and chain. It was frequently retold in the 18th century with a moral about the importance of human liberty. Samuel Croxall, a clergyman and Whig pamphleteer, included it in his well-known version of Aesop, first published in 1722 and reprinted into the 19th century. The lowest condition of life, with freedom attending it, is better than most exalted station among a court of slaves, he concluded. Much good may it do you with your fat slavery, my lean liberty for me, quipped the wolf in another version. Yet readers may also have had a literal understanding of the story of vulpine liberty and canine slavery, especially after Buffon, whose accounts of the dog emphasized the way it had been changed by its long subordination to mankind, and who wrote that wild animals displayed nature without fetters, displaying her true dignity and independence. William Smealy remarked that after the dog has submitted to the dominion of man, he relinquishes his natural ferocity and is converted into a mean, servile, patient, and parasitical slave. A description that may bear Aesop's influence as well as Buffon's, and in the light of which the fable itself reads more literally. Another case in point is personification, a ubiquitous figure in 18th century poetry, in which the attributes of personhood are bestowed on all manner of entities, abstract qualities, forces of nature, rocks, trees, and animals. James Thomson's The Seasons, the most influential of 18th century nature poems, abounds in allegorical personages. Spring and summer engage in a bit of sexual play based on the courtship conventions of the time when, refulgent summer comes, in pride of youth and felt through nature's depth, he comes attended by the sultry hours and ever-fanning breezes on his way, while, from his ardent look, the turning spring averts her blushful face. Readers attuned to personification would have envisaged the pair in human form more readily than modern readers do, and would also have automatically understood them in a figurative sense. Such tropes exert their pressure on the reading of other, more complex figures in the poem. In a world where spring can turn blushing from summer's ardent gaze, it is not surprising to find a bird mourning the loss of her chicks. But let not, chief, the nightingale lament her ruined care, too delicately framed to brook the harsh confinement of the cage. Oft when, returning with her loaded bill, the astonished mother finds a vacant nest, by the hard hand of unrelenting clowns, robbed, to the ground, the vain provision falls. Her pinions ruffle, and low drooping scarce, can bear the mourner to the poplar shade, where, all abandoned to despair, she sings her sorrows through the night, and on the bough, soul sitting, still at every dying fall, takes up again her lamentable strain of winding woe, till wide around the woods sigh to her song, and with her wail resound. Mourning and despair are not here imagined in human form, but projected onto a different living creature, who is treated as a person, while the details of her bill and feathers evoke her avian nature. Thomson follows Virgil, lines from whose Georgics he echoes here, in treating the nightingale as a bird, rather than opting for the Ovidian tradition, in which the nightingale is transformed woman, Philomela, mourning her rape by Tereus, and is further metamorphosed into an emblem of the poet. Philomela's sorrowful song becomes a bird's lament for the loss of her chicks. Thomson's mother bird is closer than Philomela to avian life, but surrounded as she is by allegorical personages, she might well elicit an allegorical reading. The representation of her grief hovers somewhere between natural observation and poetic fiction. Later in the century, under the influence of a naturalistic aesthetic and a nascent campaign for kindness to animals, the mourning nightingale was read more literally. Thomson was understood to have added something new to an ancient story by infusing his poem with concern for a real bird. In 1777, John Aiken praised Thomson as one who studied nature so attentively as well as to merit the epithet given him by Mr. Pennant of the naturalist's poet. By the 1790s, the poet's description of the robbed mother bird was lifted from its context and reprinted in works of animal advocacy. The revolutionary writer, John Oswald, cited Thomson's lines as evidence that, despite entrenched human cruelty, still we are affected by the sufferings of other animals, and from their distress are drawn the finest images of sorrow. The lines demonstrated both that an unjust society had not succeeded in completely stifling compassion, and that poetic images derived from sympathy with animal feeling. Thomas Young quoted the same lines in his own, more orthodox plea for kindness to animals. Applying a naturalist's standards to poetic description, he criticized Thomson for inaccuracy, noting that it is the male nightingale, not the female, that sings, and suggesting that the father's silence would be a better image for the bird's parental grief. The mother's pain remained central to his discussion, however, a pain which must be measured by the strength of her affection, itself demonstrated by reference to natural theology. Providence had implanted love in the mother bird to enable her to rear her young. The nightingale's sorrow was no poetic fiction, and Thomson's lines might, with some variation, be adapted by the reader to any sort of bird. An anecdote from The Natural History of Selborne augmented Young's picture of avian affection. White had reported flycatchers hovering over their exposed nest to shade the chicks from the sun. The scientific authority White offered Young was based on the same close, detailed observation of the natural world that was now being recommended to poets. Sympathy. Towards the end of the century, then, a drive towards naturalism united natural history, imaginative literature, and animal advocacy. Significant differences of philosophy and strategy among animal advocates, such as Oswald and Young, will be explored in later chapters. Here it is important to note that The Cry of Nature and An Essay on Humanity to Animals shared a faith in the natural truths expressed by poetic images and a conviction that the search for such truths entailed sympathy for the feelings of other animals. Both in science and aesthetics, naturalism was closely entangled with sympathy. The connection was fraught with contradictions, of which contemporaries, whether indignantly, uneasily, or with matter-of-fact acceptance, were well aware. The naturalists whose observations authorized emotional engagement with wild creatures' affective behavior relied on shot specimens to build up their body of knowledge. White's automatic reaction to seeing an unusual bird of unknown species was to take a gun to it. In 1781, William Smealy, whose philosophy of natural history was later to argue for the intellectual and emotional continuities between human and other animals, urged members of the newly formed Society of Antiquaries of Scotland to collect the birds of their respective neighbourhoods, ready to be stuffed and turned into the core of a projected museum of natural history. He recommended postponing this activity till after the breeding season, which circumstance, he maintained, greatly diminishes the cruelty of the persecution I propose. But he could not help adding the incompatible request to have nests, eggs, and young in the collection. The physiological similarities between humanity and brute beasts, to which, at root, calls for cross-species sympathy appealed, were discovered and demonstrated by repeated vivisections and other experiments carried out on a variety of animals. One demonstration, in which the evacuation of air from a glass jar was shown to suffocate the small creature trapped inside, was the subject of a painting by Joseph Wright of Derby, an experiment on a bird in the air pump, showing a family group watching their pet bird collapse inside the apparatus. In Wright's picture, as commentators have pointed out, scientific investigation and sympathy are divided among the spectators according to status and gender. The male demonstrator, wrapped in his experiment, the two young girls providing a focus for feelings of empathetic horror. Such a division might also exist internally to the investigator himself. In some cases, it clearly did, right from the 17th century beginnings of modern scientific experiment. Robert Hooke, who with Robert Boyle devised the air pump experiment in the 1650s, later demonstrated the link between respiration and circulation by dissecting a dog whose lungs were kept operating by means of bellows while the exposed heart was observed beating. Troubled by the suffering inflicted in this latter experiment, he required some persuading before he would repeat it for the Fellows of the Royal Society in 1667, and he did not perform it again after that occasion. The cruelty of the air pump experiment was also subject to criticism, and by the mid-18th century, humane alternatives, candles, inflatable bladders, a pair of hollow hemispheres bonded by a vacuum, were being recommended, though not always employed, as a means of demonstrating the evacuation of air without torturing a living creature. Compromised, divided, and very partially efficacious as it was, sympathy for animals persisted, and its cultural expressions spread. Sympathy was invoked to analyze the relation of self to other. It underlay the shift from reason to feeling as the basis of ethics, and it was intimately tied up with the question of human-animal relations. So popular within sentimental literature, sympathy has been less in favor in recent times. While some have considered it potentially democratic in its encouragement of fellow feeling across class and racial differences, others argue that its universalist claims of shared feeling obscured and thus upheld power differences. It has been claimed that the powerful enjoyed, to an even salacious degree, the sensation of pitying the powerless, and in doing so, consolidated social hierarchies and the claims of empire. Cross-species sympathy is at least equally controversial, open alike to charges of overvaluing animals at the expense of human life and of expressing the self-serving pity of the oppressor for the victim. Literary criticism that questions the human-animal division needs to revalue 18th-century sympathy and sentiment, because the shift in animal representation towards the naturalistic and empathetic was encouraged by sympathy's challenge to the conceptual barriers between human and animal. Studies by Tobias Menley and Jonathan Lamb have begun to rehabilitate sympathy and the sentimental. Menley argues that the attack on sentimentalism, aggressively mounted at the end of the 18th century and continued in modern criticism, is at least partly motivated by a wish to uphold the absolute division between human and animal, which sentimental writing undermines. Lamb, who suggests dividing sympathy into five kinds, associates three of those kinds with the exchange of feeling between animal and human. As we will hear, during the 18th century, sympathy for animals became an important aspect of the quality of humanity, a term encompassing both human identity and the benevolence or compassion that was described in the term humane. For many late 18th century writers, to embody humanity as it ought to be was to have a sense of sympathy or shared feeling with the non-human animal. Sympathy, as theorized by David Hume and Adam Smith, provided the intellectual basis for the shift towards naturalistic and empathetic representation of animals. Hume made sympathy a key component of the psychology explored in A Treatise of Human Nature. For him, sympathy denoted an involuntary transmission of feeling from one creature to another. His friend, Adam Smith, developed the concept differently in A Theory of Moral Sentiments, emphasizing an exchange of feeling in which sympathizing subject and object of sympathy remain distinct. And in Lamb's words, imagination supplies the bridge between cases that are always ultimately different. These differences between Hume and Smith, I suggest, revolving as they do around the extent to which sympathy is understood either as a physiological response or a mental activity, correspond to the current debates on the nature of empathy and are the source of their different contributions to the shift in animal representation. In Book 1 of the Treatise of Human Nature, Hume establishes the principles of animal-human similarity which underpin his discussion of sympathy. He introduces what later became an influential argument from analogy to support his claim that animals have mental lives comparable to those of humans. 'Tis from the resemblance of the external actions of animals to those we ourselves perform that we judge their internal likewise to resemble ours. And the same principle of reasoning, carried one step farther, will make us conclude that, since our internal actions resemble each other, the causes from which they are derived must also be resembling. Hume argues that animals learn in a Lockean manner, from experience, and avoid danger or pursue pleasure by judging from sense impressions, a reasoning that is not in itself different, nor founded on different principles, from that which appears in human nature. Animal reason, confined to experience and memory, does not reach the heights of abstract reasoning available to humans. But this difference is less significant for Hume's explanation of the mind than the simpler mental processes common to beast and man. He aims to describe the mind as working on mechanical principles, without recourse to the Cartesian idea of an immaterial soul directing its operations. Other philosophers err, he considers, by introducing overcomplicated explanations of mental phenomena, requiring a subtlety and refinement of thought beyond either animals or most people to account for simple inferences. As he puts it in The Inquiry Concerning Human Understanding, even highly educated men, such as philosophers themselves, in all the active parts of life are, in the main, the same with the vulgar and are governed by the same maxims. Hume brings together two principles of action long considered distinct, animal instinct and human reason. For him, animals, far from operating entirely on unvarying impulses, are capable of learning from observation and experience, and such experiential learning operates in a mechanical and unconscious way, not only in animals, but in human beings. The kind of reasoning used by most people most of the time is a swift deduction from sense impressions and memory, a species of instinct or mechanical power that acts in us unknown to ourselves. Reason is simply a variety of animal instinct, nothing but a wonderful and unintelligible instinct in our souls. Sympathy, as described in Book 2 of the treatise, also unites humans and animals in the simplicity of its operation. For Hume, sympathy is essentially the communication of feeling from one sentient creature to another, though it is a mental operation internal to the subject, whereby the idea of a sentiment or passion is turned into the impression of the passion itself. It can be prompted by simple physical cues and is facilitated by physical contiguity and similarity. A cheerful countenance infuses a sensible complacency and serenity into my mind, as an angry or sorrowful one throws a sudden damp upon me. The same process of absorbing the moods around them occurs in animals. 'Tis evident that sympathy, or the communication of passions, takes place among animals no less than among men. Fear, anger, courage, and other affections are frequently communicated from one animal to another without their knowledge of that cause which produced the original passion. Grief, likewise, is received by sympathy and produces almost all the same consequences and excites the same emotions as in our species. The howlings and lamentations of a dog produce a sensible concern in his fellows. This invocation of animal sympathy underlines Hume's view that it is an automatic bodily response. As such, it operates best where the transmitter of feeling resembles the receiver. We sympathize most readily with people of similar manners, character, country, or language, while dogs sympathize with other dogs. However, cross-species sympathy is possible and demonstrates once more that the phenomenon is a response mechanism. Hume's attribution of sympathy to close proximity helps him to define it as mechanical. 'Tis true, there is no human, and indeed no sensible creature, whose happiness or misery does not, in some measure, affect us, when brought near to us and represented in lively colours. But this proceeds merely from sympathy and is no proof of such an universal affection to mankind, since this concern extends itself beyond our own species. Physical closeness, or its representation, triggers an automatic response. There is nothing lofty or virtuous about sympathy. We can't help it, any more than animals can, and animals, as well as humans, both feel sympathy and can be the objects of our sympathy. Though Hume did not himself develop a concept of animal rights, his work prepared the way for others to do so by representing humans and animals as similar creatures, governed by the same kinds of corporeal and mental mechanisms. His work challenged the distinction between rationality and animality that had been dominant since the Greeks, and sharpened in the 17th century within Cartesian dualism. Descartes' mechanistic account of the body left non-human animals, in the absence of an immaterial soul, beast machines, operating without consciousness or thought, and according to some, without feeling. while in human beings, the body's activities were governed by the rational soul. These ideas sparked off a controversy about animal souls that raged for a century and a half. The Cartesian beast machine had little support in Britain, where several defences of animal soul were mounted in the 18th century. Hume was dismissive of the body-soul distinction, which had absorbed so much philosophical attention. In an implicitly monist passage of the treatise, he remarks that bodily pains and pleasures arise originally in the soul, or in the body, whichever you please to call it, without any preceding thought or perception. Hume's work influenced the development of a physicalist model of human and animal psychology in the 19th century, and he is now considered a forerunner of modern cognitive science because he treats the study of the mind as like the study of any other natural phenomenon. For him, the self did not, as in Cartesian thought, inhere in a rational mind able to control the instincts. It was rather a succession of related ideas and impressions, and by implication belonged to animal as well as human life. Adam Smith's discussion of sympathy in The Theory of Moral Sentiments owes a great deal to Hume, and like Hume, he offers examples of spontaneous sympathy with the bodily sensations we witness. We flinch to avoid the stroke we see aimed at another. Spectators twist their bodies in tune with the rope dancer. Weak people itch at the sight of a beggar's sores, and even strong men's eyes feel the irritation they see in another's. Smith, however, emphasizes and extends imagination's role. For Hume, imagination converts the lively idea created by someone's pain or pleasure into an impression of the same emotion in us, and the process of pity requires our being close to the sufferer. Pity depends in a great measure on the contiguity and even sight of the object. Smith, while agreeing that passions sometimes seem to pass between people instantaneously and antecedent to any knowledge of what excited them, considers that this does not happen universally or with regard to every passion. Knowing the cause of another's feeling is needed for the full development of sympathy, which does not arise so much from the view of the passion as from that of the situation which excites it. Smith's famous discussion of sympathy as the process of imagining ourselves into another's situation downplays the role of the senses and loses the immediacy described in Hume's account. Though our brother is upon the rack, as long as we ourselves are at our ease, our senses will never inform us of what he suffers. They never did, and never can, carry us beyond our own person. And it is by the imagination only that we can form any conception of what are his sensations. Neither can that faculty help us to this any other way than by representing to us what would be our own if we were in his case. It is the impression of our own senses only, not those of his, which our imaginations copy. By the imagination we place ourselves in his situation. We conceive ourselves enduring all the same torments. We enter, as it were, into his body and become in some measure the same person with him, and thence form some idea of his sensations, and even feel something which, though weaker in degree, is not altogether unlike them. His agonies, when they are thus brought home to ourselves, when we have thus adopted and made them our own, begin at last to affect us, and then we tremble and shudder at the thought of what he feels. Smithian sympathy, then, is a complex mental operation, involving becoming aware of and adopting another's perspective. Because the process involves an act of imaginative projection, the people we sympathize with need not even feel the emotion we feel for them. We blush for a rude person who is unaware of his own mistake. We commiserate with a madman who is altogether insensible of his own misery. A mother feels more sorrow for her infant's pain than the child, lacking her fear and anxiety, feels for itself. We even feel for the dead. While Hume emphasizes that we most easily sympathize with those who are like us, for Smith, sympathy can bridge differences via the imagination. A man may sympathize with a woman's childbirth pains, though his own body is incapable of ever suffering them. These differences between Hume and Smith have a contemporary parallel in discussions of empathy. Some neurophysiological discussions of empathy consider it an automatic process in which responses in the brain, detected through fMRI scans, mimic those in the brain of the object of empathy. The term for the neurons involved, mirror neurons, even echoes Hume's claim that in sympathy our feelings mirror another's. While empathy, considered as a physiological communication of emotion, sometimes referred to as contagious empathy, has much in common with Humean sympathy, Smith's view of sympathy as imaginative projection is echoed in accounts of empathy as a high-level mental activity, sometimes known as cognitive empathy, in which the ability to understand and adopt another's mental perspective is key. Then and now, differences in the location of sympathetic or empathetic responses lead to differences in their attribution. Those considering empathy a contagious physiological response are more likely to consider, as Hume did for sympathy, that it is found in non-human as well as human animals.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.